Our first speaker this morning is Autumn Kent from University of Wisconsin-Madison with a talk entitled Unword Hyperbolic Surface Bundles.
Nice to be here. Thanks for the invitation. I'm sorry you all have to be inside. let S be an enclosed orientable surface. I guess I'm going to typically want at least two, probably. Okay, and you know, normally what I would do is I'd give a long background on convex compactness, and then the talk would be over. So I'm not going to do that. So I'm interested in bundles. So this is a bundle. So I'm interested in a fiber bundle like this, where my fiber is X. Okay? And I'm interested mainly in the question when is E hyperbolic? And I'm deliberately going to be maybe vague about what I mean by hyperbolic. But when you grow up as a three-manifold person or a three-manifold polygon, you know examples of this, at least if you grew up as a three-manifold polygon at the right time. I mean, you know, Thurston didn't know that these existed at first. if B is a circle, then this happens a lot. So this is hyperbolic. So this is a theorem due Thurston, Bill Thurston, and this is hyperbolic. If and only if the fundamental group of the total space, you know, does not contain a Z plus C. Okay, so this is by the long use exponent of vibration. You know, this will be a circle incident. It's actually a reducible manifold by three manifold topology, and so this is actually all of the hypothesis for the geometrization theorem in that case, and for the hyperbolization theorem in that case. So there's an algebraic abstraction to being hyperbolic, and so. Right, so now, what do I want to say? Pi 1 of the circle, you know, it acts on the fiber, you know, up to homotopy. This is just true of any bundle. You just walk around a path in the base, and then that gives you some homeomorphism of the fiber, and then it's well-defined up to homotopy. So if you move the path, and then your two bundles would be the same, giving the same bundle. So we get this map of the homotopy, and then so I can think of, I get for a representation, I can think of this going into the, so we've had three notations for this now that I've seen before I arrived. And so this is the mapping class group, so this is orientation for their homeomorphisms, you know, of the isotropy, or homotopy, whatever. Right, and so I can rephrase, you know, Thurston's theorem. This is the same theorem that E is hyperbolic. So I'm going to think of this as, well, this is an infinite cyclic group. I'll call this B. And then this is hyperbolic if only if phi, is super normal. Which is just like saying that the preserves no conscious in class. No conscious. So how do you get a Z plus C subgroup in a bundle like this? Well, if you're over the circle, you have the Z element, the fundamental group is a semi-direct product, and so you have this element of the fundamental group. You know, the obvious way to get a torus is to, you know, just fix some curve in your fiber, and then you walk around. You walk around, the homeomorphism fixes a curve to get a torus. And that's a little group theory tells you that's exactly what happens. And then that's super awesome. Or that's what super awesome. Okay, so this is our criterion that the base is a circle. And I like to, you can tell I like to go slow like graduate students. So what about in general? So in general, there's no hope. But I shouldn't just talk about life, I guess. So for a general bundle, B could be junk, right? So just take B to be something really, just really horrible space, okay? Like a torus, or the two sphere. So that won't be hyperbolic. Let's not do that. So in general, probably not. So here's a maybe, but you know, what if B is nice? B could also be a surface that's not one of these. You know, B could be a surface, a hyperbolic surface. Topologically, you need to be homeomorphic to the block surface. This Thurston's theorem is like, here, this hyperbolicity means, constant sectional curvatures, minus one, or, you can pick up, E is hyperbolic three space modulus and discrete period. And so you could ask this version of the question, is there a real hyperbolic, a bona fide hyperbolic? So this is bona fide Latin for constant sectional curve. So here, I'm just using, for a hyperbolic surface, I just mean, they're a genus of these two. Okay. So that's a question. Okay. And then it's conjectured that the answer is no. So I don't really understand the reasoning in any deep way. So there's the point is that so this is a would be a hyperbolic four manifold. Okay, so this is four manifold. So there's a conjecture that the Seibert width invariants of the hyperbolic four manifold vanish, and But it's also known that if you have a bundle like this, there's an old argument of Thurston that you can put a symplectic form on it. So this will actually be a symplectic manifold. You just build it using the symplectic forms here. And so using that, you could find a finite cover of it that had non-vanishing subgroup. So okay, so don't ask me any more about that. But there's some physical reason. There's some people who study cyber I believe this. So there's no actual hyperbolic manifold like that. So what I'm interested now in is, you know, is there a weaker version? So weakened hypervelocity. So is there a bundle like this with delta hyperbolic? You know, you could just ask, maybe, you know, you could even just ask, is there a bundle like this? You know, you could just actually just put the question here and then just ask for, you could just ask this kind of question and then just, you know, ask for things that aren't the circle or, you know, where the fundamental group isn't, you know, virtually Z. But it turns out that you're, right, so let me just, because I have this in my notes, you know, I have this, right, so I'm just interested in this question, so like, you know, when, maybe the question is, like this, that's not a comparison, when does a bundle like this have so I'm going to assume some nice things, you know, okay, they're jokes, but, I want B to just be some cell complex or something, but we always get, I always get a representation of pi 1 of B, you know, into the map class group, okay? And then, so I get, you know, a short exact sequence like this. And then I'm going to assume that B is a spherical, so that I get a 1 right here. So this is just from the long exact sequence of the vibration, and so like if, you know, if B were 2 spheres. So I have this short exact sequence, and I'm just interested in the bundle is that one. Any question? Okay, so here's a theorem. Bar and Mosher, and independently due to Ursula Hammerstein, that pi one. So throughout the talk, I should also say I'm gonna assume. So this representation could have kernel, okay? So like if the fundamental group of B is just some infinite simple group or something, it's boring, might have boring image. So let's just assume pi 1 of B is actually contained in on S. Okay? So in every example I would ever be interested in, and not just in some general setting, that would happen anyway. So I have this theorem that says that pi 1 of E is if and only if plot one of the base. So this is now, this is just some abstract group, but I'm thinking of it sitting inside the mapping class group. So I actually, when I write this, I'm always thinking of it as a subgroup of the mapping class group. And it's what's called convex compact. And so that's not a very satisfying theorem because you don't know what that is. Okay, so I haven't defined what that is. And normally I would spend a lot of time telling you what it is, but I'm not going to. Well, I'll tell you something you will understand. So that'll count as a definition. So I'm not spell my ear right now. So here's a theorem that Heinlein and Heen is delta hyperbolic. If and only if the orbit map. So this is sitting. So I don't know. Maybe I need to. So pi 1 of E is sitting inside of the mapping class group, S, and it's acting, the mapping class group acts on the curve complex of S. Okay. If you have any subgroup of the mapping class group, there's an orbit map. So if if G is a subgroup of mod S, there's an orbit map. So this is bad word work from G to the curve complex, and it's just you pick any vertex and then G gets set to G times D. If a group actually has an orbit map, orbit map. There's lots of orbit maps, but is a quasi-asymmetric map. So you pick some word metric on pi 1 of B, and then I have a map into the curve complex equipped with its metric, its path metric, used by the whatever. And I just want to say that the bundle will be delta hyperbolic if this orbit map is a QM. This isn't how we knew the definition of compass with the path. Okay, so we have a map to the curve complex, and if that map is Q embedding, then you get to the bundle. And so the idea is supposed to be that if you're an example you should think of is think of the curve complex and take two, let me maybe just give you an example. Take B and C pseudo-Nosoffs that are independent. And so let me just draw the curve complex. There it is. And then here's phi and C's sort of quasi axes. And then if you raise these to some huge power, so there exists an M such that this is a theorem, I guess, due to the Mosier. You take, there's an M such that if you raise these two to high power, this is going to be magnetic. So this will give you a new example of a bundle where the base is just a wedge of two circles, and the bundle is delta hyperbolic. So you think of this as like you have this tree here, but this is a huge power, so the rest of the tree is sort of far away. And then, as you you know, running along here, it sort of looks hyperbolic because you're just like a bundle, and then it just sort of looks like that in all pieces. But it's not really just, but that's a good. Okay. So this is just true in a hyperbolic. Once you know this theorem of with Chris and Ursula, this is a quick proof of this. So if you have two hyperbolic elements acting on hyperbolic space, it'll sort of always be nice and QM embedded this way. Okay, so here's the theorem that I wanted to talk about. So this is joint with Faustina. And so the theorem is that pi 1 of E is double hyperbolic if and only if pi 1 of E is, so I need it to be purely pseudo-Nosov. So that just means all the non-identity elements are pseudo-Nosov. And the map from pi 1 of B, just the map into the mapping class group, is a quasi-asymmetric invariant. So notice that I have this here, I just have the orbit map to the curve complexes of QI embedding. And here I have to assume something else, that pi 1 of B is purely pseudo-Nosov. And that's necessary. Okay, so you can have, you know, just cyclic things that are QI embedded in the mapping class group that fix off the curves. Okay. So you could have a cyclic subgroup that would be a counterexample of QI. That
hypothesis.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Loudon says that it should be
unsolved. Oh, right, yeah. I should probably say that. Oh, that's what it's supposed to be.
Oh,
we
want that.
Yeah.
Okay,
that's yeah. Okay. Anything else? Other? Is everybody okay? So what's the difference? But a lot is lost. So if you lose what you but a lot is lost. Okay? So I'd like to talk about what's lost. Okay, so let me let's do some examples. Vertices in the curve complex. So the curve complex says you have the vertices are simple closed curves of the isotropy, and they join an edge. If they have an edge between them, they're disjoint. And so let's consider, say, I don't know, the game twist in gamma. Okay. So in the curve complex, I see this picture. Okay, and like I actually a Dane twist in gamma just fixes those. But this is some this is if I raise this to powers, right? This is moving in the mapping class group. It's moving. Yeah, I S. Linearly. And then but nothing's happening in the curve complex. It's like no movement. Okay, so the orbit mass T gamma over gamma, and it's gamma, so that's no progress at all. If you're a little bit away, I don't know, like if I, so if I'm, I don't know, if I'm another curve like this, I will move. Over here, these aren't joined by an edge, and so maybe that, these are actually moving around. So maybe it's making a little progress, but it's still staying close to beta, and then, it's not moving far. So a lot of progress is lost. Great, so let me, I want to do a more interesting example. Right, so I want to draw this picture again. Forgive me, beta is over here now. Okay. And then, so now what I want to do is I want to pick, so now, like, I want some more complicated problem to show you, a lot being lost. So I want to let phi be pseudo-Nosov, say on S minus gamma. Okay, so imagine if the only conjugacy class, say it's gamma. Okay, and so it's very chaotically acting on everything else. Okay? And then, so if I apply phi, I get phi beta. But that's still disjoint from gamma. So there's still an edge here, and like this has moved say a lot. I don't know. And then I can do it again, and I get phi squared beta. And I can keep going. And then I just keep doing that. And beta or something. And then I have some new curve called delta. Okay, so this I'm never going to appeal to this notation. It doesn't matter. And so I have these spokes going around of all of these curves. It seems like they're moving beta a lot. This is, they're converging to some dimension if you just did this forever. And then, but you're always disjoint from gamma. And then, that's like a moving pseudo-Nosov move kind of linearly in the curve complex of this. Okay. But not in this big curve complex. We're not moving at all, really. Okay, so now I want to show you, so I lost a lot. Okay. So now I could keep going and build lots of mapping classes. Like I could do phi like a bunch of times. And then I could do some other mapping class to multiply by something else. So I'll take something, I'll take C and pseudo-Nosov on S minus this thing. And then I could hit that alpha is in the complement of that. So I could hit alpha with C. That's not an alpha. Is that alpha? It's a gamma.
Gamma.
Thank you. Okay, and so I'm going to do that again, I get b squared. So I have this picture. This new thing. And that could just sort of keep doing it. And so this, you know, you think about, here's some new mapping class, and like, I've made a little progress. I've moved a few, like two, three, moved in sort of distance three, but I've lost lots of information. Like, I could build sort of progress this way by just sort of doing this, building this hierarchy picture, if you know what that means. And I make progress, but I'm losing a lot at all the intermediate steps. And like on a much bigger surface, you know, I could also do this like as I go along, you know, you could add complexity. It's very complicated, right? You do these wheels, you know, all around. But I've lost a lot of information. But, you know, in the mapping class group, right, notice that, you know, what have I lost? So I had like linear growth, you know, on each of these sort of individual subsurfaces, and I'm losing that each time. So if I kept track of that, maybe I could actually see what the mapping class group distance is. And so let me just point out that, you know, when you're doing the pseudo-Nusselt on here, you're moving, so this is moving linearly in the curve complex of S minus gamma. And this is like the link of gamma in the curve complex. So you have these smaller curve complexes where you're not losing, but in this big curve complex you've lost. So if we just kept track of all of this. And it turns out that the word length is always given by this picture. So Jason has already talked about this a little bit. Let's talk about it again. Okay, so what do I mean? I want to start, you know, by saying I want to have a geometric model. And so it's called the marking complex. Okay. So the vertices, so it's kind of like the curve complex. The vertices are what are called markings. Sort of an overloaded word. And I'm not going to tell you what it is. It's like a pants complex. It's like embroidered pants. Pants. Decomposition. Sort of extra curves, so transverse. So if you just took a pants decomposition, then the pants decomposition. You know, if you do a mapping class, you might see it move, but if you do a Dane twist in any of the pants curves, the pants don't change. So you need sort of something to keep track of the twisting. So another way to think of it is just like 100 curves or something that can be determining everything about the surface. Okay. And so then we have these, also to describe this statement that actually Jason has already described, Masur-Minsky subsurface projections. So you let Y is going to be a subsurface. So you think it's a pi one injective subsurface, and then And then the projection to y of a curve, you know, gamma is a curve on S, some surface of S, curve on S. And then the projection to y, I just want to think of it as like gamma intersected with y. Okay, that might be empty, okay? So if it's empty, you don't do this, you just don't do anything. And then if it, what do I mean, gamma intersected with y? Well, just take y to have geodesic boundary, and then take gamma to be the geodesic representative, and just in some fixed hyperbolic metric, and then just literally take the intersection, okay? And then you object that that isn't a curve, because it has boundary, and then so you just work with arc complexes instead, if you're lazy, or you do some surgery sort of thing to make it curves. Okay? And it'll be well-defined up to some set of diameter t. So that's this projection. And then I have this, what's called the Macer-Minsky subsurface projection coefficient. Okay, so if I have two curves, I can project both of them, and then I'll just, the diameter of that set in the curve complex of that subsurface is. So with the diameter of this projection, respect to both of them, of both of them to that subsurface, and I take this diameter in the curve complex of y. Okay. And then if there's some degenerate case where y is an annulus, and then you have to be a little more careful about what you do. But it's okay. Make sure to see both of them. Oh, I should also say a fancier version of just intersect with y allows you to project markings. So there's also a marking projection coefficient where I do the marking complex I'll call M of that. It's a really good one. Okay. It's not the moduli space, I would use a fancier. So you project to the marking complex. It's like if these are two markings. So the theorem to Macer and Minsky is that if you look at the word length, then this is approximate, this is like whatever the quasi-equivalent, to you take the sum, so this is what Jason did, and you look at all the subsurface projection coefficients, of, you know, you pick a marking, so mu marking, and you look at g mu, okay? And then you throw away all the small ones. So this is, this notation means you throw away, you know, this is zero if smaller than a. So it's exactly all the distance in the mapping class group comes from these subsurface projections. So if you do a mapping class, there's a bunch of projections, and if you're really far away, you know, say from the geodesic joining those two points, then the projections won't be big, and then that's also due to Macer-Minsky. And then you have, well, that's part of it, and then you have all these big projections are coming from sort of walking. But they're sort of not ordered or anything in some obvious way. Okay. So observe S is one of the terms. So y equals S is a term. It's one of the indices in the sum. Okay, so if that term, you know, is, what was that? Right, so if you're worrying about a group and you want to know that it's 2i in the Kerr complex, then if that term is sort of linear in the length, then you're linearly moving in the Kerr complex because you're moving in that main surface. So I'm going to talk about an element of the group sort of moving. Okay, so if G, if this term is linear in G, in the length of G, then you're moving. We're moving linearly. The Kerr complex. And so that's what we're trying to do. We want to. If you want to prove this theorem, right, and you know your QI and mapping class group, what you want to do is show that you're moving, you know, linearly in the Kerr complex, and then you know that you have a hyperbolic bundle. Okay, so that's the goal, is to try to promote the QI-ness, the linear movement in the mapping class group to linear movement in the Kerr complex. So we just assume like we don't have that. So another observation, so the other key point is if one of the other terms is moving linearly, is linear. There's like, you know, unique quantifiers in all this, but it's linear in the length of G. We claim, you know, we get a reducible element. So this is not much less obvious. Okay. So let me write down this lemma. So we call this the pigeonhole lemma. So if you have G is finitely generated in the mapping class group, and U is a marking. Okay, so let me, I've written down carefully the statement, so maybe I should trust myself. Let me write it down. The statement is, you give me a proportion, so you give me a percentage, and then as long as if you have an element in G that's long enough, and it has a huge, you know, and the projection to the marking complex of some subsurface is that, you know, proportion of the length, then there's a reducible element. So if you have a sequence of elements, and then, you know, there's a linear, you know, there's a fixed proportion of the length that's sort of carried by projection to the subsurface in the marking complex, then you actually find a reducible.
So what's the last word?
Then there exists a reducible in G. So the idea is, let me just, I don't have a lot of time, but so sort of, here's me, and I don't know, I'm going to think of, like, I have, like, my, I'll sort of blur the distinction between the geodesic and the image and the happy plus group and the curve complex here. But I have, like, mu and g, and then I can sort of break this up into pieces. And it turns out that if you have really long words, that where you have a projection to a subsurface that's carrying some linear proportion of the length, then it turns out that if you break up your word into like g1 mu and then g2 mu or whatever, and so on, that actually I can look at the subsurface. I can take this, break this up into sections where this is kind of long, but still with some sort of fixed fixed length. And then it turns out that if I'm really, really long, then a lot of these have to have, I'll have a big projection between these two, but that projection will have to show up in some segment. So the projection, there's this sort of principle that if you have, say you have these two points, say, in the marking complex or in the curve complex, and then you have a big projection to y, so this is like the boundary of y here, then I look at this geodesic, I have a big projection here, then actually I can sort of work with a truncation of this geodesic, and I'll get a big projection here also. So I don't really need the full geodesic. Okay, so then basically some sort of just counting tells me that in this situation, I actually have to have lots of these segments where the projection is good. Okay, so I have like, say, a big projection here to this z, to some z, and then I have a big projection between these two here, also to z, and then I have maybe a big projection here, also to z. Okay, so no, this is the same. Because I know this linear proportion to this one.
So, when you couldn't left, you're saying that. Can you say it again?
Right. So you break up the path into these. Into these segments that are sort of long enough.
Well, this picture is in the marking graph, not in the curve complex.
Yeah. And so I have this. So I have these big projections, but they're all the same. And so, but now if I pull these back to some fixed neighborhood of the beginning, I'm in a finitely generated group. So actually, there'll only be finitely many subsurfaces where I can have a big projection. So if I pull this z back, I'll get some junk, right? So if I pull back by the initial element, the initial word, I'll get some element that has a big projection at the beginning. And then I pull back and I get some different one, okay? But that's a finite set, and I'm going longer and longer and longer elements. And then, so I'll have to have some, eventually they'll repeat, so there'll be some fixed w back here. That if I pull back this one here, I'll get W. And way out here, I pull back and I get the same W. Okay. But then if I take those initial words and I multiply one of them by the inverse of the other, it'll fix the W over Z. So, is that okay? That's okay, so, so I'll have some initial segment, sort of H here, and then H inverse of Z is W, and then W is also K inverse of Z, and so then K. Okay. So Okay, so that's if I am move, if I have a fixed subsurface, and I get bigger and bigger elements where that subsurface, you know, has a linear proportion of the length carried by the projection of that subsurface. Okay, and now I just need to extract such a subsurface. So now if the sum of, so I'm sorry, I'm going to go over a minute. So if this is sort of sublinear in the length of G, you know, I want a Z, well, you know, I want a contradiction. Well, I want, yeah, I mean, what was it? Right, so let me set it up. So if the main term isn't linear in G, I want a Z such that this, you know, marking distance, you know, is linear in that linear. And then I'll have a reducible element that violates my hypothesis that I have a purely supermassive subgroup. Okay, so so how do I do this? Well, the idea now is we have, you know, this distance in G is like, you know, this, it's the sum over all subsurfaces. And but it turns out that there's a theorem due to Vespina, Bromberg, it's like this color theorem, the complex, that says that I can replace this sum, you know, I can it's okay to work with a subset. So you can replace this, say, with a linear, you know, some fraction, a subset of certain subsurfaces. With the property that any two of them intersect. Right, and so then when you sort of, you have this, you know, this picture walking through, but you can sort of have this picture where all the subsequent surfaces intersect each other, and as I walk through, but the idea is you have all these subsurfaces in this sum, and there's actually an order on them, so there's actually an order, there's an order on the subsurfaces in the sum. Okay. And so what you do is you you just sort of walk through the sum in the order until you fill up the biggest surface you can fill up, okay, and then you stop. And that's like G1. And then you walk through the surface some more, and you take all the subsequent subsurfaces until you almost fill up the surface. And then that'll give you some second element, G2, and so on. Okay? And so each of these elements in the product that gives you G will have a subsurface associated to them. And if it's really, really, if you have a lot of growth in that subsurface for G1, you get a reducible element by this lemma, because you're actually moving in the marking complex when you do this. Okay? And then so you just assume that you don't, so you don't actually make a lot of progress in each one of these. And then when you write down the appropriate inequality, it's just not enough for this sum to actually be linear in the mathematical screen. So I'll stop.
use your theorem to construct an abundance of Pseudo-Nosov mapping classes, like a definite proportion of large balls.
Yeah, I don't know.
In your proof of the pigeonhole demo, mm-hmm. did you need to pick specific hierarchies to do this marking?
No. It's just the
mechanics. If the proof is okay, if one surface has a large growth, then its conduits count. Or probably finitely many of the conduits can, then
I mean, the idea is that in a ball, right, in a fixed ball in the group, right, there's only a finite and a big projection. So that's sort of the one key point. So when you like the triangle inequality and knowing this growth basically tells you that there has to be lots of these. Where there's a big projection, and when you pull them back, you're only getting some finite set of things. So you have that other
one. Any questions?